also like to thank the organizers for this and for inviting me. This looks very interesting. So the influence of water on rheology and seismic properties, the outline of the talk, first I'll like to go over large strain rheology, so large strain deformation experiments, in particular in dislocation creep. Then I need to say something about water incorporation in olivine and point to the importance of extrinsic defects. So this is a new aspect of this. Then we also, as we find out, as we're doing these experiments, and we need to think about oxygen fugacities in the samples, at least if not in the mantle. And then lastly, seismic properties. And just as a reminder, up to now, we've been thinking globally. Now we have to start thinking about the grain scale, and in particular, also the relationships between grains, grain boundaries, and then grain internal deformation. So we're scaling down by quite a bit from earlier. The experiments are done in a gas medium apparatus. The advantage of this, even though the pressure is very low, we have very high fidelity of resolution of stress and strain rates because we don't have friction essentially due to the gas as the pressure medium. The samples in these particular experiments are surrounded by either iron nickel foils or by platinum, and I'll come back to this quite a bit. This does begin to make a difference. And one important aspect, and again something that I'll mention a number of times, is that we don't add any water. We don't have any water buffers present in this assembly. The water that we have in the samples, we think, comes from adsorption on the very fine-grained powders when we load the sample. So this is all that there is, the water content that we then measure in the samples. Compression here indicated alumina pistons, and these metal foils serve to isolate the sample from the surround, also the steel jacket on the outside. The samples themselves, this is iron-bearing olivine. I think that also is becoming important that we have iron present because that interacts, of course, with the oxygen fugacity in the samples. And importantly, these are doped, these olivines, with a range of titanium contents. And why we do that will become clear in the next few slides. This backscattered image shows nice microstructure, sort of idealized. You always see hexagonal grains. Of course, these are not quite hexagonal, but quite a nice microstructure before deformation. And the grain sizes, this is also important. The grain size is a few tens of microns. So in this particular sample, something like 30 micron is the mean grain size. So these are relatively coarse grain for experimental samples. And that has to do with, again, the presence of water, which enhances grain growth. The rheology, you already saw flow loss that looked something like this. The strain rate is something that we measure. We impose the stress here, and we impose also a temperature. And then in this flow law, we can measure the grain size as well. We then fit the data to this kind of flow law, and we constrain these exponents, so the stress exponent, the grain size exponent, and the activation energy, as well as this pre-exponential constant. We don't have an activation volume here because of all of our experiments are done at this, as I mentioned, relatively low pressure. So if we extrapolate to the mantle, we have to take an external an activation volume derived on other, from other experiments into account. And then the strain rate is the sum of two or more mechanisms, so the total strain rate here, diffusion creep, dislocation creep, grain boundary sliding. Most of the experiments are done in dislocation creep, meaning that we have a nonlinear dependence of the strain rate on stress, in particular exponent of 3.5, and then this is grain size independent. So the exponent P here for the grain size is zero, in contrast to the diffusion creep, linear, and then cubic grain size dependence. When we have water present, we need to add another term here. This is the water fugacity or the concentration of water, and that has its own exponent R, and that's something else that we fit in the experiments. So here the result, so wet samples, the key part is wet samples become weaker with increasing water contents. Nothing particularly new, but this was questioned recently with the argument that most experiments, or almost pretty much all experiments so far, have been done water saturated. So there was a question what that does, the water saturation, to the rheology. And then the suggestion was made that the water, the dependence on the strain rate on water content is much more mild than in previous experiments. at the water under saturated conditions, we confirm that we have a strong or linear dependence of the rheology and the water content. You can see here in this plot stress versus strain rate, the black lines are dry rheology, so no water present. And then the more water we add at constant temperature, the weaker the samples become. And then the activation energy here, so experiments done at higher temperatures. The symbols are the measured pairs of stress and strain rates. And then these lines are fits to the, as I said, to the flow of all the data. And you can see that we have scatter in the experiments. Some of these, the water contents don't seem to agree with what it or the measured water contents don't predict the right rheology here. One problem is that the water contents in these samples is not exactly homogeneous. So we have to average the water content, and possibly we're not doing a very good job. That's probably the largest source of error in these data. But overall, the fit is relatively good. The slope is 3.5, so that's the steeper slope. At the lowest stresses, we see the transition into diffusion creep regime, but there's not very much data in this diffusion creep regime. Most of it is in this dislocation creep regime with an activation energy that's given here. And that agrees with previous determinations of the rheology. Hirth and Kohlstedt and also Jung and Corrado have very similar parameters for that. So, as I mentioned, the key difference to previous experiments is that we're water undersaturated. And no buffer, the point is that the mantle is water undersaturated, so we were trying to link where the water is in olivine, a normally anhydrous mineral, so the structural incorporation of the water in olivine, with the rheology that we measure. And this is an infrared spectrum. You shine an infrared beam through the sample, you measure the absorbance here, and what you find is that you have in these samples two absorption bands that stick out. Here the wave numbers are given, and this is characteristic for a particular site, so for structurally incorporated water or hydroxyl. In addition, we have this broad absorption region in the infrared, and that's molecular water. So we need to look at both components, the structurally incorporated water and the molecular water. That's the advantage of determining water contents by Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy rather than SIMS, for example, in that we can actually see where the water resides in these samples. So the importance of titanium comes in that these two bands, right, these are the same bands that I showed earlier, in untreated San Carlos olivine, so natural olivine that experimentalists like to use for their experiments, these two bands can only be produced experimentally with different olivine compositions, with different buffering environments, if the sample is buffered by rutile, TiO2, meaning that the olivine contains titanium. So these other samples, as you can see, you don't get the same two absorption bands that we see in our experiments as well. You really have to buffer with titanium here, this rutile buffering. These are piston cylinder experiments that go back now a while. So titanium is important. That's why we started doping our samples with titanium. The model for the incorporation of titanium is that the titanium sits on the octahedral side here in hydrous olivine. Titanium is 4+, so you have a silicon vacancy, and that's charge balance by two hydrogens. And these two hydrogens, the vibrational frequencies, then give rise to these to the absorption in the infrared. That's work from Walker et al. The incorporation mechanism of the hydrogen in the olivine, so here is titanium in dry olivine, sits on the silicon side, very similar to silicon. You add water, you get titanium on, as I just showed, on the octahedral side. The two hydrogens on the silicon vacancy, this is this titanium kind of humite-like point defects, and then you get periclase. The important part here is showing these equations is that you can get this defect either silicon or enstatite buffered. So if you have enstatite present, then you just react the periclase to form olivine, or magnesio-vustite buffered. That explains a lot of the experiments. You see these two absorption bands independent of silica buffering. And the concentration of this particular species of hydroxyl then depends on how much titanium you have in your sample, in your olivine. And that's also what we find. So we've doped the olivines with a range of titanium contents. And when we measure both the titanium content by SIMS, for example, or by laser ablation, and the hydrogen content by FTIR, we find that we indeed find fall near, the compositions fall near these 2-to-1 line that's predicted from this incorporation mechanism. Here, the fact that we're falling off really means that we're close to saturation or at saturation, so we have probably titanium oxide, some free titanium present in these samples. And these are the corresponding spectra to these, to the hydrogen contents here. So an important point is that this hydrogen incorporation here is not the total storage capacity for water in olivine. Under water saturated conditions, you can put a lot more water into olivine, which then sits on different structural sites on in the olivine crystal lattice. So we're not saying this limits the total amount of water that you can put in the olivine, but this is the defect, certainly at the low pressures that we have, that gets hydrated first. So that's the defect. Really what we see in these spectra is the only hydrated defect. And going back to the rheology, we have to still distinguish between this molecular water that we see in the experiments and the structural water. So here the molecular water content in this region here versus the hydroxyl content, the structural water. The molecular water, if we try to fit that, one problem we have is that we can't that the fit does not go through the dry rheology. Chopper and Patterson, very coarse-grained materials, Hirth and Kosted here, finer-grained materials. So the molecular water has this as the biggest problem, whereas if we take the hydroxyl content here, we can the fit with a water concentration exponent or water fugacity exponent of one or a little bit larger than one, the fit goes through the dry rheology. So we're arguing that that is the appropriate fit to the data, and that that is the rheology that we're measuring, and that we then can apply to the upper mantle. So one important aspect is that this deformation is intragranular. So this is before and after. This is before deformation. We have, as I said, this very nice hexagonal texture here, microstructure, without, except for a few cases here indicating probably grain growth, without much grain internal deformation, whereas after deformation, we have large grain internal strains indicating movement of dislocations, and that corresponds to the measured rheology here, that the strain rate depends on the stress to the exponent of 3.5. So dislocation creep. And another important point is that in these hydrous samples, the grain boundaries are very mobile, so we have a high grain boundary mobility, and you can see that the grains are intergrown in three dimensions. So this is a two-dimensional slice, the same color, is the same orientation. These grains are really intergrown, so the grain boundaries are very mobile. That is also shown hydrostatically by the much more rapid grain growth that's also been measured for a long time in comparison to dry experiments. So just briefly to summarize, that's what I said. An important aspect is that while under dry conditions, grain boundary sliding seems to play a role, under wet conditions, we don't seem to see any indication of grain boundary sliding. Grain boundary sliding is grain size sensitive. So all these experiments, when we look for a grain size sensitivity, we don't find that we need grain size as a factor to fit our rheological data. So this is grain size insensitive. One other aspect that's work in progress is that all these experiments were done at 0.3 GPA. The question is whether the same mechanism holds up at higher pressures. And this is work now going back quite some time by Dave Kolstad and others. If you water saturate your experiments, you get much more water in the olivine, but your infrared spectra look quite a bit different to those of the natural olivines. So these are the first experiments, again, under water undersaturated conditions, exactly the same as the deformation experiments, put the powder in a platinum capsule. And so up to 6 GPA at least, you find the same absorption band. So this is work just done. Robert Farlow collaborated with me on that at the BGI in Bayreuth. So water incorporation, extending it to higher pressure, you find the same kind of defects, but you can see that there's another peak that appears to be important here, and that's due to iron 3 plus. So in these relatively oxidizing conditions, we begin to see hydration of iron 3 plus at higher pressure. So there's a slight hint here at 1.5 GPa, and you can see there's a little bit there, but this seems to become more important at higher pressure. So, as I said, work in progress. Extrapolation then, water contents, so water contents in olivine, that's back calculated from the water contents in MORP that's erupted and the partitioning into all the different phases in the mantle. So water contents in the olivine in these units of ppm hydrogen per silicon, so you can eat more easily, that's the geophysical unit, account for where the hydrogen sits in the structure. The water contents in olivine around this range, and that gives you viscosities in the oceanic asthenosphere that are inferred from various different means for asthenospheric mantle. For cratons, if there is a lot of water in the cratons, they can still be relatively strong even if they contain water, if they're cold enough. So then you have to trade off with temperature, and these geotherms are fitted from seismic profiles in lithospheric, in cratonic lithosphere. So application of that. Now, as I said, we have to look at the water content, or the oxygen vogacity rather, in the sample interior. And we did that by adding small platinum particles to the interior. You can see here, so that's the platinum capsule in this case. These white specks here, these blobs, are platinum iron alloys that equilibrate over the duration of the experiment, and we can then measure the iron content here in these with the microprobe and measure the iron content in the olivine and calculate the oxygen fugacity. And we did that, you can see here two traverses indicated, that's adjacent to the sample, I'll show that next. And then the band, basically we analyze these blebs here, of course they're not connected to each other, we analyze the composition of the blebs perpendicular to the sample capsule interface. And for the adjacent to the, so the small profile here, adjacent to the capsule, we measure a diffusive loss of iron into the platinum, and that's been well known. The petrologists have struggled with that for a long time. If you put platinum next to olivine, iron-bearing olivine, you lose iron. And that is a nice diffusion profile with a diffusivity of the order of 10 to the minus 14 meters squared per second. The more surprising aspect was that if we then look at the composition of these blebs, and an important aspect here is the scale is micron here, the scale now here is millimeter, that's the blue, that blue-green here is the olivine composition, you barely resolve this drop in iron content in the olivine here at the edge, but if you look at the composition of the platinum blebs, that changes up to 1.5 millimeter into the sample. And then these two are used to calculate an oxygen fugacity. So you can see the oxygen fugacity in the interior of these samples is constant, but it rises quite steeply to the platinum capsule. So there's a gradient in oxygen fugacity here, and that gradient has an implied diffusivity of the order of 10 to the minus 12 per meter squared per second. And another important part is that in the interior, the oxygen fugacity seems to be constant, but if you then compare a platinum capsule with a nickel capsule, the oxygen fugacity of the nickel capsule is lower. And for the nickel capsule as well, the gradient in oxygen fugacity is much smaller in spatial extent than for the platinum capsule. So if you look at the interior, so the flat parts, the oxygen fugacity here in the interior of these samples, here, on this axis, oxygen fugacity, log of oxygen fugacity, number of buffers, so iron rustite, iron buffer here, nickel-nickel oxide. And you find often that there is an assumption that if a sample is encapsulated in nickel-nickel oxide, that that's buffering the whole sample at nickel-nickel oxide. And in fact, here is the nickel capsule, the oxygen fugacity that we calculate is closer to the CCO, the carbon CO buffer, rather than nickel-nickel oxide, so substantially lower, and you can see that only the very outer rind starts to rise in oxygen fugacity. So the interior of these large capsules are not really at the buffer of the metal that surrounds them, except if you look at iron here. And an intriguing aspect is that since you have a uniform oxygen fugacity over the interior, but it is dependent on the material, the metal that you encapsulate the samples with, that the diffusivity here has to be very fast. So it has to be something like of the order of 10 to the minus 10 meters squared per second in order to impose the oxygen fugacity as a function of container in these samples. So if you look at this, the diffusivities here, this is 10 to the minus 14, that corresponds to grain boundary diffusivity together with bulk diffusivity of iron here. That's the oxygen diffusivity, so grain boundary diffusivity of oxygen gives that this value. And to get these really fast diffusivities, you really have to appeal to, for example, hydrogen or polarone diffusion in olivine. So that those are the only charge carriers that then can diffuse fast enough to impose an oxygen fugacity. So that's an important point, that you need to think about the oxygen fugacity in the interior of these samples. And I'll come back to that. That seems to become very important for our seismic properties. Very briefly, the introduction. So instead of compression, we have a torque, but the key here is very small strains. So we are in the linear regime at these very small strains that we excite the sample, and we measure the shear modulus, the elastic modulus, as well as the energy loss in these experiments. That's done, of course, by Ian Jackson at the Research School of Earth Sciences in Canberra. We fit the data to a Burgers model where we capture the full range elastic, the viscous, that's the normal convective behavior, as well as anelastic. And very briefly, for the simple Burgers model, we have an attenuation peak. We don't see this peak, so we need to superimpose many of these. Superposition of peaks gives then an absorption band, and that's really what we see in these experiments. This is the absorption bands over many decades in frequency. We have variation of the dissipation as a function of frequency, or period increases to the right here. You can see the temperature dependence color-coded here. The shear modulus also temperature dependent as well as frequency dependent. And an important part, this is one grain size. If you measure this for different grain sizes, we find a grain size sensitivity. And that together then can be explained by models such as this, where you have diffusionally assisted grain boundary sliding, so diffusion distance as a function of time scale, right? Because you're in a regime where you reverse the stress, so you diffuse along the grain boundaries, but you never quite go to completion. That gives rise to this absorption band. The important point here is that grain boundary properties are very important. So if you go back to the large strain deformation experiments, what we think we see there is the motion of dislocations in the crystal interior and the enhancement due to this particular defect that enhances silicon diffusion. Here we're looking at grain boundaries and the properties of grain boundaries. If we apply, so what I showed here was dry data. If we apply the dry data, the attractiveness is that for old oceanic lithospheres and asthenosphere, we can match, and that's very schematically shown here. So the experimentally extrapolated values match quite well with observations. So it becomes interesting if we then do the same experiments as we did for large strain deformation in iron nickel capsules, same setup for the seismic properties. And that's work in progress by Chris Klein, a student at ANU, and he'll present this at AGU as well. So these are initial results from these wet experiments. And the surprising part is really shown here. We have the same frequency dependence. So this is this absorption band for dry samples and iron nickel. So the frequency dependence here is very similar. But what we find is that instead of a perhaps expected implicitly dependence on water content, similar to what we saw in the large strain deformation experiments, the indications are that this behavior is much more binary. Either it's wet or it's dry. So that, the frequency dependence for wet and dry, but no systematic dependence on water contents. So we have a range of water contents, but we don't see a systematic variation of the properties as a function of water content. It's either wet or dry.
1 minute.
Okay. And this is related to the encapsulation. So platinum capsules have this lower modulus and higher attenuation in comparison to the iron nickel capsules. And as I said, there's also a difference in oxygen fugacity. And perhaps it's not that surprising that we should find something different than for the large strain deformation with grain interior processes. Here we're looking at grain boundaries. This is a high resolution TEM image. Grain boundaries, we know that again for quite a while, are enriched in elements that are incompatible in olivine. So in here shown here is calcium, aluminium, and titanium. The red dots, grain boundaries, the green, grain interior. So the grain boundaries are enriched. So you would expect that grain boundaries, if you have something incompatible like iron 3+ or hydrogen, that these are also enriched in the grain boundaries relative to the grain interiors. And something similar has been seen here for rim growth experiments, again, depending on grain boundary transport, in that you have a similar binary behavior, either dry or wet, and wet is independent of water content. So that's illustrated here. That's very similar to what we find. Just background here, so these oxygen fugacities, and that's related to what we find here, so that the oxygen fugacities in subduction zones are a bit more oxidizing than what we have in these samples, but we cover essentially similar oxygen fugacity ranges as you'll find in the upper mantle. So that's really the summary, so the dislocation creep. An important aspect is that the question then becomes, how directly can we translate seismic observations to rheological behavior if the sensitivity to water content is very different, grain interior versus grain boundaries? So, thank you.